guys.
I know. You don't need to worry about it.
You're fine.
I don't need to worry about it. Oh, my gosh. Hey, we're live. Hello, everybody. Good afternoon or morning or whatever day it is, because I'm literally so jet-lagged, I don't know what... I don't even know what day it is right now. I've been flying for, like, 40 hours, and then I landed and I lost my luggage, and I finally got my luggage, and that's why I'm wearing this new necklace. But anyway... Hey, this is Vaginal Fantasy, and if you don't know what this is a book club where me and my lovely, awesome three co-hosts discuss one book a month that is in the genre of Vaginal Fantasy, which is, yeah, like, genre of... Oh, gosh, I'm doing it again.
You're doing it, you do it every time.
I need to do it. It's Inception Felicia.
I was doing so good, too. I was holding it together. I'm not that drunk right now. Anyway, let's talk to our co-hosts, because they are not going to ramble like I am. Bonnie?
I'm going to ramble. There's going to be lots of rambling, because I haven't had much sleep either, because I've been, like, writing and writing and writing, and I don't go to sleep anymore. So no promises that I'll make any sense whatsoever.
That's not good. What are you writing? Are you writing a new book?
Three new craft books, a comic, and then daily articles for CNET.com.
That's crazy.
So, you know, stuff. But at least it's fun stuff. So I get to write about geeky things, which is good.
Okay. Kiala, have you been sleeping? I mean, you look lovely and rested.
Oh, thank you. Yes, because I have Ambien now.
Yay!
And it finally kicked in for me. It works. Works wonderfully. I love it.
Do you just, how long does it take for you to sleep, like, go to sleep after you take the pill?
10 minutes.
Really?
No way, really? Mm-hmm. That quickly?
Yeah.
Wow.
That's what I should have taken on the plane, because I could not sleep on the plane on any leg whatsoever.
But doesn't Ambien make you sleepwalk, eat?
It can with some people, but I would highly suggest taking it and then having someone you know read their master's thesis on why there are no heroes left in the world or something. I don't know. I fell asleep within 3 minutes that time. Just FYI.
Okay.
I'm not a doctor. I'm not a doctor. So
you're not a doctor. You're not prescribing me Ambien. You're just
sleeping. Yeah.
Yeah, I should.
Veronica is describing, this is how it is for me. This is my experience.
Veronica, you're, like, nodding vigorously right now.
Oh, right. Yes, Ambien is a hell of a drug. I only take it when I travel, because I have a hard time sleeping in hotel rooms. But, yeah, but be careful, because it's very habit-forming people out there. It can be kind of gnarly, and it can also make you have crazy dreams and sleepwalk and leave your hotel room. So I've heard.
Yeah.
You look like...
So I've heard. No, that has not happened to me.
It can make you sharpie your roommate's forehead with penises.
What?
I'm kidding. She didn't do that to me, but that would have been hilarious.
Does Ambien help you make better relationship choices?
No. In fact, it's actually proven so women are much more sensitive to Ambien than men are. And so typically the dosage on Ambien is between 5 milligrams and 10 milligrams. And they actually suggest that women should be taking, you know, maybe even half of the 5 milligram tablets, maybe even a quarter. So just be aware that you shouldn't overdose on Ambien, because it can knock your socks off. That's my professional doctor opinion.
Dr. Belmont.
I just do poor person Ambien, which is just, and a fifth of scotch.
Yeah, it works too.
What are we drinking tonight before we get into the local meetup?
I'm drinking in honor of Felicia returning. I'm trying tiny wine.
What?
Yeah, I don't know. Why, am I supposed to be the big drinker? I am, aren't I?
No, I love it.
Instead of the giant glass, I'm drinking out of the Vaginal Fantasy wine glass.
Oh, I'm using that too right now. I can't remember. Look, I'm perspiring everywhere. Look.
You are perspiring everywhere. Your English is weird now. You're like Madonna, because you've been all over.
Four of these already.
Oh. Doesn't really count as tiny one.
No, this will be six. This is five. So I'm still drinking a lot. It's just tinier.
It's just, you have to work a little bit harder. You're burning calories by opening, like, twisting off.
I feel like this is kind of like diet wine.
Not if you drink six of them, but okay.
Well, yeah. Well, it's like those fat-free cookies, right? You're only supposed to have one, but they're fat-free, so six.
Yeah, it's true. Veronica, what are you drinking tonight?
I'm drinking a Cabernet Sauvignon. And it's good. We did Sword and Laser earlier today as well, so I busted open this bottle of wine for our What Are We Drinking segment. And it's good.
Kyla, what are you drinking?
I'm drinking rosé in a pint glass that I poured from a box. But it's the La Vielle, the chicken wine. You guys know what I'm talking about? The La Vielle. It's got a chicken on the front. It's a good rosé. It's like a $10 rosé, but the box is like $25, and there's 4 bottles inside of it. I just love being able to just
I just killed him off with my hand!
What the hell?
What just happened?
It's on me!
What?
I just killed him off with my bare hand, and now it's smushed on my monitor, and it's all over my hand.
Why did you do that?
Why would you get in my face?
It's because you're so luminous, Veronica.
No, but I have to say, Felicia, I know you've been traveling a lot, and you've been very tired. Your skin looks like it's been, like, real-time photoshopped. You look, like, really? Luminescent. Yes.
Okay, listen, do you know what it is? It's eating tapas nonstop, and which I bought a whole bottle of to celebrate tonight because Spain knows how to eat.
Yeah, they do.
And I have to tell you, I have not been eating healthy, but here's my theory. I've been eating a lot of mackerel.
It has a lot of those omega-3
fatty acids or whatever they are. Yeah.
I think it is because every single night I would eat fried anchovies or like mackerel or some kind of tapas with like the kind of oily fish you never get anywhere here in the States. And I think it's different because I feel dewy.
Yeah, you look dewy in a good way. Like you know how people say like girls don't sweat, they glisten. You're like dewy from the inside out, but like in a really attractive way.
I'm not hitting on you right now. If you're saying all the right words.
It's working. Okay, good.
Okay, awesome.
Okay, let's get before it gets weirder because I'm getting a little bit drunker. Let's do a shout out Before we get into the book, which we discuss a book every month, hopefully strangers aren't bored right now, but I usually give shout-outs to all the local groups who are Vaginal Fantasy members, and then people get together in different cities and countries and to talk about the books themselves or other books they're reading together. And last month, we left a couple people off, so I want to do a comprehensive list, and if I leave you off this month, I owe you another one. Last June, the San Francisco Wicked Grounders met up. The Buttered Crumpets Google Hangout met up. The Cincinnati Dayton Ghostlight Gals. The June Vagabonds.
That's clever. Instead of vagabonds, it's vagabonds. I like that.
Vagabondings. It's vagabondings. The vagabondings. That's pretty. In Alberta. The East Coast Vaginal Fantasy Hangout met, and the Vaginistas Google Hangout met. And then next month, the San Francisco Safe Words July meetup. Oh, they changed their name!
Oh, yay!
They changed their name, and I felt bad because I really wanted them to be the Grinders, like the Wicked Grinders. Yes. And they're like, that sounds like a sandwich.
When are they meeting?
They're meeting July 13th. The San Francisco Safe Words are meeting July 13th.
Maybe I'll go.
Great work.
Veronica, are you going to be around?
I'm moving that week. I'm moving on Saturday, so I have to. I'm going to be deep in moving land, but I will try.
Have you been packing? Because your office looks the same.
No, it should look super clean. I mean, this is the cleanest the office has ever been, and that's because we threw away so much stuff. But no, we haven't packed yet. Soon.
Are you excited?
I'm super excited. Yeah, staying in the city though.
Oh, that's. Oh, you are. Oh, that's. Yes. Okay.
Yeah, don't leave, please. I don't have very many friends here.
Okay, and then the Buttered Crumpets UK Google Hangout is scheduled for next month, and the Vaginal Fantasy NoHo chapter is meeting. So if I missed you, I'm very sorry. We're trying to get the methodology down to collect everybody properly, and I will start a thread in the forum to figure out what the best way to collect them all is. Okay, let's talk about the book. Yay!
Yes! I feel like we have been... This book has been the book of the month for like 3 months now because we had a long month and because, you know, I started reading it a little early, and it's Man, this book was phenomenal. Kylie, you picked this one, right?
I did.
Hey, Kylie, this is
my mind. I mean, this was like, gosh, even, I'm sorry, I'm kicking things off because I can't contain myself.
Do it.
Oh, I've been wanting to talk about this book.
Can you read the back of it first so people know?
Yeah, let's read the back of it. Let me just read the title and then, Veronica, you go to town. The book is called The Lions of Al-Rassan by Guy Gavriel Kay. And here's a description. Kay's thoroughly excellent new novel resembles his song for Arboron in that there's no magic in it. Instead, he deftly and intelligently blends history at a slightly different angle. The setting is a variant on early medieval Spain, where Muslims, Christians, and Jews are also suitably modified. The story turns into rivalries between the kingdom of Al-Rassan, once mighty but now split into quarreling principalities, and the kings of the Jadites. Further to the north, the Jadites hope to reclaim Al-Rassan, which was once theirs. Into this skillfully imagined, eloquently described stew of war, intrigue, and magnificence happens a warrior from each side and a female physician. The threesome's adventures constitute the bulk of the long but never padded, demanding and enormously rewarding novel.
So, yeah, this is, I mean, well, it's definitely, like, based on Iberian Peninsula, so, you know, Spain and the region surrounding that, and, I mean, it's just a really superb, like, almost like an alt history, mm-hmm. and it's fantastical, but yet it feels very rooted in our own history, but at the same time, there's not a lot of fantasy elements to it, which I think might have confused some of the people who are reading along with us, but what is really special about this book is that though it has romantic elements in it, it's really about the relationship between the three main characters and their kind of like interconnecting relationships. And I really feel like the relationship between Rodrigo and Amar was almost more poignant and important to the story than, I'm going to pronounce people's names wrong, so I apologize, but like Jahan or Jahane?
I would say Jahan.
Jahan.
I say Jahan.
Jahan, okay. So, like, she's an amazing character and obviously a very strong female protagonist in her own right, but I really liked the relationship between, you know, Belmonte and Ibn Khayran. Again, I didn't listen to the audiobook, so I'm really bad with names. And also, I was a little biased because his name was Belmonte.
Right? Yes, so you liked it.
Yeah, but it was super complex. I mean, it was super complex. The prose, obviously, Guy Gavriel Kay is one of like the, you know, the best writers of his generation. He just he got like the Canadian award where they become like, it's like being knighted but in Canada.
Is it a back bacon?
Is it Fillion?
Sir Back Bacon?
Back Bacon?
Sir Jelly Donut coming.
What?
I'm sorry.
Everyone's already drunk.
Anyway, he just won an incredible honor from Canada, where he lives, and he's a fantastic writer, and, you know, I shouldn't have expected anything less from the guy who wrote Tagana, but it was a real pleasure to read, and it was just a real meaty read, and, you know, something that even someone who isn't interested in fantasy, obviously, you know, could be into. This is like a literature book, you know? This is like a serious, like, really well-written, awesome book.
Just a shout out to the audience. I just noticed that YouTube changed their interface again, and there's no scrolling chat for people to actually interact online, which is kind of a drag. So I'll try to find an alternative immediate chat situation that we can all participate in during the Hangout next month. But for now, go to Twitter and use hashtag Vaginal Fantasy, and we will take questions and comments from that. And we will figure out another way to get chat-like features next month. Maybe we should move to Twitch, guys.
Maybe. Maybe we should.
I don't know. I don't think you could do anything non-gamery on Twitch, right?
We have to do Justin TV.
Yeah. All right. Well, we'll talk about it. Anyway, Kyla, do you want to talk about this book and why you picked it and why you loved it?
Yeah. You know, it's funny. So I started reading Guy Gavriel Kay in college. And, you know, I was an English major. So he was my introduction to high fantasy. And I didn't know that even existed. I mean, I'd read some fantasy, but I'd never read like any kind of like real like books that were like 600 pages long. Like I'd been reading science fiction and all that kind of stuff, but I hadn't been reading this. And then so I read A Song for Arbon first and then Tagana. And then I read The Lions of Al-Rassan, and this one just blew me away. I mean, I love the other two, so much. Mm-hmm. But this one, it's just like, it's like you can smell the sand. I don't know. It's so good. I love Jahan, although I would like to talk about her pee flask because it sounds like something that you drink out of, and that's a problem. And her father's urine flask. And then, I love everything about it. And I agree with you, Veronica, about Rodrigo and what's his name?
His first name is Amar.
Amar. Yeah. Their relationship is so poignant. And he does that thing, and I don't want to, well, I guess it's a book. But he does. Guy Gavriel K does that thing where you're sure somebody's dead, and then they're not dead, and then you sob for like an hour. He does this great thing.
Oh!
I really thought he was dead. I was sure.
Yeah.
And it's pretty amazing. I love this book, and I loved getting to reread it, especially during the summertime, and then it was awesome. Must be great for you, Felicia, too, because you were actually in Spain and all these places. So.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Of course, I love this book, and it was so cool because Tigana is one of my favorite books of all time. I have it in hardback on my to-keep shelf, which there's not a lot of books on there. And I mean, there's like four shelves of hardback fantasy books that I go out of my way to get a copy just to have, and that's one of them. But I hadn't read this one. I love his mosaic duology set in Byzantine
times. The Byzantine ones, I love those too.
And the Fionnvar tapestry, which is a really great sort of younger leaning about a bunch of people from here who go to a fantasy world, and it gets awesomely dark. I can't believe there isn't a TV show about it yet.
Oh my god, that gets really dark, and I love those, but I don't love them as much.
Yeah, they're really good. I think they were developing something. Anyway, but the cool part was that not only did I get to read this book while I was on vacation, but I went to Spain, to the very places that a lot of these things fictionally were happening. So I went to Seville, and I went to the palace there, where they're going to be shooting Game of Thrones for Dorne. And I didn't know that, but it's the most amazing place you've ever seen, because it's this amalgam of Moorish, all the Moorish Muslim art mixed with the Christian art. After they came, they moved in, but they actually retained some pieces of architecture that are just breathtaking. I mean, literally the most beautiful place I've ever been is this palace in Seville.
And then were there fountains and like pools, like Dorne?
Yeah. And like there water coming out of lions. And
yes, well, then I went to, the whole reason I went to Spain was I wanted to go to the Alhambra, which is, and I have to tell you, the palace in Spain is actually more beautiful. It was way less crowded, so it was a lot more enjoyable anyway, but it's a lot more beautiful, in my opinion, than the Alhambra, because the Alhambra has a lot of old but also new areas. It was breathtaking as well. But there's a courtyard in the Alhambra that's called the Lions. The Lion Fountain. I was going to upload the picture. Yeah, I'll try to tweet it. I'm going to tweet the picture. But they just cleaned it and just put it out again, and it's called the Courtyard of Lions. So I looked at it, and I was like, oh, my God, that's the book I read. So
amazing.
It was amazing to read that book and then experience all the history at the same time, being in the exact same place in the world. This book is so good. It's a little bit hard sometimes. There's a lot of world building, and he changes point of view a lot so that he keeps you on your toes. So that's the one struggle that I have, in that there's a lot to learn. It's very dense, and it's like Game of Thrones, in that you have to be willing to jump in and learn all these different backgrounds. But once you, if you go in knowing that the sun, the people who worship the sun are supposed to be Christians, and the people who worship the stars are supposed to be Muslim, and the doctor's people are supposed to be Jewish, then if you go into the book knowing that, it completely is clear. And anyway, Bonnie, I could talk a long time about it. I'm going to try to tweet that picture.
Guy Gavriel K was anointed to the Order of Canada. Thank you to Donald, and also Glennon Bell, so for clearing up that.
Wow, what a great name.
Yeah.
Okay, Bonnie? Yeah. Bonnie?
I'm still going to call it being Fillion.
Okay.
Right?
I think you're like that.
I think when you're knighted in Canada, you should reference Nathan Fillion at all points. Okay, so here's a fun fact, and this is why I read hardcover books actual books is because, see this lovely map? Yeah, if you were on Kindle, that was after the story was done. As were the list of principal characters and how they all relate. So you Kindle users had to be done with the book, and then you got explanation who everybody was. So
I don't know. I didn't really need that. Like, I didn't think it was that.
Well,
once, I made the connections between, like, what it's supposed to be representing.
It's hard to believe, but not all of us have the concentration level and attention span of a scholar. Some of us, like me, have the attention span
of a... deal. Just don't worry about what I'm doing. It's not a big deal. Just don't worry. It's fine. It's fine.
A giant box of wine.
It's just...
Kayla's doing this. It's too distracting, and I want to see how much she's drinking.
There's just nothing. It's fine. It's fine. Thank you.
Drinking?
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sure. You have a wine. You have a wine butler in your house.
Yes.
I do. I don't have a wine butler. I have a wine dog. She doesn't do anything.
She needs to deliver you. It needs to be like one of those Saint Bernards with like the thing around her neck with whiskey.
You know, that's not true. They don't actually do that. I asked when I went on my first skiing trip, and I was laughed at. That's not something that actually happens.
Oh.
All right.
With the hashtag. Anyway, tell us what you like to put.
This handy map. And, you know, I don't really like books like this normally because I already got my English degree, so I hate having to take notes while I read. And this reminded me a little bit of like the Game of Thrones, Lord of the Rings thing, where there's a map, there's a bazillion characters who all have names that sort of sound the same, kind of like Shakespeare. You know, like in Shakespearean plays, they always have the list of characters at the beginning, sometimes a map, and all the characters are very confusing. So to me, it was a hard book to get into. I mean, I'm glad I stuck with it. I almost lemmed it. Because it was very, very... I know you're all in shock because you love this book and want to be buried with it, but I had a lot of problems getting into this book because it was almost too much backstory, almost, dare I say, too much world building, almost too many characters, so it was hard to focus and try to figure out who I should care about and who I should remember. So I found myself rereading a lot. And maybe I'm just stupid, I don't know, but I had to reread a lot. I had to draw an outline of who was related how, because even though the characters are listed at the beginning of the book, it was still kind of like keeping track of the sons, keeping track, you know what I mean? There's just a lot of members, family, well, more than, yeah, lots of members. But
it's not as bad as Lord of the Rings, right? Like, at least everybody has different names. They're not all Eowyn and Arwen.
What's his name? Like Amar, and wasn't there another A name, Alamar?
Yeah, there's three A names.
Alamar.
I did agree with you.
Because don't judge me harshly. I know a lot of you are thinking I'm stupid, but I went to the polls. There were a lot of our viewers that said the same thing. So don't.
Hey, Bonnie, it's Lem. It's Lem. First of all, you're not stupid. Second of all, no, this is Lem talking to you. I'm talking to you. Okay. You're not stupid. You're not stupid.
Your puppet doesn't think I'm stupid, but everybody else might.
Nobody else thinks they're stupid. Some books on for everybody. It's not a big deal.
I didn't say it was bad. That's the thing. Like, the story is well written. The dialogue's there. The characters, even though there's a bazillion of them, they're all characters that are kind of cool and kind of interesting and compelling. So it wasn't like it was a bad book. It just, after reading a lot of kind of easy, light reads, getting into this book is you kind of have to be committed to read this book. And you have to care about finishing it, and you have to want to finish it. Because
Wait. Life is too short to read books you think suck.
I didn't think it was sucky.
It's okay. No, it's okay. I mean, you don't have to, you shouldn't waste your time on books that you don't like. That's the whole point of reading. It's to read stuff that you like. That's why we're here, to discover new things. Not everyone's going to like everything that everybody else likes. That's why it's a book club, because we learn from each other.
Don't feel bad.
Don't feel bad about it. Nobody's going to judge you.
We're in therapy.
I'm a dragon. I can say these things.
I'm a dragon. I can say what I want.
Hearing me a lot. But anyway, I will say that, you know, it was kind of hard to keep track of. But, and I don't know if there really was enough romance and sex that this book, for me, didn't really qualify as romance, unless you count bromance, then it's totally romantic. But because the two guys, I mean, that was, it was like a buddy film. So I don't know. I just, it was hard for me to get into. I didn't hate it, and I'm glad we read something a bit more challenging than we usually do. But at the same time, it took me the full time we were allotted to read this book. It took me the full time to read it. Like, it wasn't a quick read at all.
Yeah, you're right. It was definitely, it was more like Kuschel's Dart, I think, would be the comparable book that we've read before. Very dense, very, very complicated dialogue, a lot of characters going on, a lot of world building.
I mean, Kuschel's Dart wasn't hard for me to get into, but this one was, and I don't know why. I don't know if that's because there were a lot of political and religious themes in this book, and that's both of those things are not anything I care about. So maybe that's why, but then I was just like, if I can get into Game of Thrones, the books, and if I can get into Lord of the Rings as a kid, I should be able to get through this. So,
well, we had other comments in the forum. Mia said, right up front, the book hammers you in the face with names and characters, but it got easier when the story properly started with Jahane. A lot of people said they really appreciated the strong characters, and the biggest comment was the about the friendship between Amar and Rodrigo, which is interesting, and I just want to bring this up. This is the first male author we've had on Vaginal Fantasy in 30 episodes, and what do we think about that? Is that not a Vaginal Fantasy if it's a male author, or is it not? I mean, whatever we pick. We've already decided whatever we pick is, you know. And this did have romance.
It did seem obvious to me that it was a guy writer in some respects, because I felt like, and maybe I'm just, I don't know, I hate saying that, because then I feel like I'm being sexist in a way.
I think he writes women really well. It might be just this book for you, because in the other books, in like Tagana and A Song for Arbonne, he's definitely, there are a lot more women, I think that they're written really, really well. There may be just not as many women in this book. That there's just really Jahane. But I love her romantic storyline. I understand why you wouldn't, because it's not like really consummated or anything.
No, I mean, I don't necessarily care about that, because I read a lot of young adult books that don't have elaborate, detailed sexy times either. So that's not the big deal to me. It did seem to, maybe it's just because it concentrated on a lot more guy characters than I'm used to. Because usually when we read these books, the guy characters are the romance characters. You know what I mean? They're not the main, they're not major. They just seem to move the story along.
And it was a lot more understated, too. I think there was a lot more subtleness to the romances in the story, because Jahane and Amar, you know, they get together in the end, but, you know, she has some, you know, some unexplored feelings for Rodrigo.
Mm-hmm. And he does, too, but
he loves his wife, but, you know, it's complicated. He's away a lot, and he sees something in Jahane, so it's there's a lot of, It's a little more subtle than I think what we're typically.
I personally loved when she got together with Alvar, right? That was so great. Like, and for being in college too, that became like my whole thing. Like, don't be weird about this in the morning, okay? we're doing this, and this is all it is.
We're sexual creatures.
So just don't be weird.
That's what I liked about, you know, I sometimes get really bored with the sort of predictability of some romance books, because, you know, it's almost like some of them are like paint by numbers, in that here's the scene where they first meet and they're going to have friction, and there's one scene where they go a little bit too far and the girl stops, you know. And the cool part was that even though you kind of knew there was an instant connection between her and the dashing, I mean, he's basically James Bond of medieval Spain, right? Amar. And you kind of know that, but the fact that she didn't fall head over heels, and her whole story isn't all about what's Amar doing? What's he doing? You know, she doesn't go back to him. She's like, oh, we're going to move on with our lives, and he comes back into her life, and then it progresses from there. But her whole journey isn't about getting him, which I appreciated, because that's more interesting than just, you know, I mean, sometimes it's fun just to have it be only about the romance, but that's what I thought this was refreshing, that it wasn't that.
Lady G on Twitter said that it wasn't very romantic. The relationship between the two guys was more, quote-unquote, romantic than the actual romance, which I thought was an interesting statement, because we had a section in our forums about, I think Veronica started, just to talk about the bromance part, and a lot of people, you know, chimed in saying, yeah, it seemed, and it was more like mutual respect. It wasn't like they were, you know, having Tom of Finland sexy times at the gay bar. I mean, they're not, like, actually getting it on, but they had probably more of a level of respect and adoration that you would think in romance books usually belongs to the female and the male that are hooking up.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. That's what I got from that. Oh, someone also said, Jay Aguirre said that this book is like Kuchel's Dart, but with bondage replaced by the unification of Spain.
Loves that comment. That was hilarious.
Yeah, it was really
perfect.
Let's go down the characters. What did you guys think of? We talked a little bit about her, but you know, Jahane as a vaginal fantasy heroine, because really, really, vaginal fantasy I think just needs a really strong point of view female character. Mm-hmm. What did you think about her? Was she realistic as far as the historical context of a woman doctor in 1492? I mean,
she felt a little bit sometimes to me, a little bit of a Mary Sue, like a little bit like almost too good to be true. Like she didn't seem to have any real weak points aside from the fact that she couldn't really, like, she was kind of a hard ass sometimes, but I don't see that as a downside. It was just like maybe one of the, you know, less robust aspects of her personality. I'm not sure. But you know, she was a doctor, she was like super smart, she was like matter of fact, she kind of owned her own sexuality. She was very upfront about it, and so all those things were super admirable, but I didn't always find her extremely likable. So I think that may have been my only issue with her. I think I found the male characters a lot more likable than I found her.
Why didn't you find her likable?
I'm interested. You guys think that's because a male wrote the book?
I don't know. I mean, I think she was an excellently written character. I think maybe just I would rather have hung out with the
dudes.
Do
you know why though? Because things happened to her versus her making things happen. She's the one in the beginning who vows to get revenge against the king who murdered all the royals, and her
energy taken away from her. Yeah.
Yeah. So she leaves the town saying, "I'm going to come back and kill this guy." When she gets when they try to assassinate her and try to kidnap the girl, the kids using her, the rival faction tries to kidnap children who are going to inherit the throne to try to overthrow the government. And she comes and gets rescued by that kid, you know, you know what I'm saying? So the one proactive thing she does in the book that's really proactive is when she insists on them stabbing that guy. So basically, she goes to a village and she meets Rodrigo there. He's from the Christians and she's a Jew. And they go to this Muslim village where this bad Christian guy has basically massacred, and then he rapes a woman and kills her. And she basically accuses him, and the son of the murdered woman basically kills the guy, and she instigates that. And that was when I liked her the most, because she really made things happen. But everywhere else, she's kind of goes along with the story, and which is driven by her joining the war camp of Rodrigo and Ammar. And in fact, what really made me the one thing that made me mad in this book was that at the very end, Rodrigo's son has a brain hemorrhage, right? And her father has had his tongue cut out and his eyes poked out. He's blind and mute. And rather than have Jahane do the miracle surgery and save the kid's life, somehow the father, who literally hasn't done anything in 4-5 years since he had his eyes poked out and his tongue cut off, he performs miracle brain surgery.
That maybe would have been nice for her to do. Yeah, that would have been a good empowering moment.
I don't know, like, is brain surgery like riding a bike? Do you do it enough? It's like you always remember how to do it, or do you have to keep, you know, practicing brain surgery on less fortunate patients?
They said particularly he'd never done the surgery, so it was like a miracle surgery.
Listen,
I was on House, and I played a blind architect, and I was always like,
I saw that.
Could you draw up when you were blind?
I don't know. I asked the question in the show, and did not appreciate me asking that.
Oh. What? Did the guide dog, because I have the guide dog puppies, did the guide dog draw the pictures for you?
Huh.
Really?
No, I'm asking you.
Oh, no.
Yeah, these are guide dog experts, so these questions need to be answered.
I should probably know this.
I feel like there are more important questions, like, what does Hugh Laurie smell like? And
I know, does he smell like musk and leather-bound books and tea?
Cinnamon.
Because he's British.
Now there's fruit flies in my office, so I don't know what's
going
on.
I love it. Felicia's like, huh? What? I didn't hear you.
It's like Bugmageddon.
Just kill them all. Just kill all of them.
I had a question. I have what James had a comment on the forums. When Velaz died, who's like a 60-year-old sort of attendant to Jahane, the main woman, he says, it reminded me of when Matthew died at End of Green Gables, which made me sob so.
Oh, yeah. That was sick.
Richard Farnsworth.
I love
the
Green Gables.
That's really sad. It was really sad.
I cried.
What did you guys think about Amnar?
Man, he sounds super sexy.
Yeah, he was like the other Rodrigo. It was they were two sides of the same coin.
They were different. I think Rodrigo would have been like the. So I had this like crush on my volleyball teacher when I was in high school. My volleyball coach. I feel like I would have felt about Rodrigo the same way, like man in power, you know, sexy yet sensitive, like you know, uses his power wisely, doesn't take advantage of the people under him, blah blah blah.
He had a great volleyball team.
Yeah, and so that's kind of how I feel about Rodrigo. Like he'd be like a super cool dad, but also kind of you know like hot dad.
Hot dad. He's a dilf. A dilf? Is that a dilf?
He's a dilf. Yeah.
I don't know. I was having hot dad issues with the Sarah Jane Adventures. I don't know if you guys watched that Doctor Who spinoff, but there's super hot, and I was just like, this is a kid's show, and I'm thinking great fan fiction ideas.
But then Amar is like kind of, I thought of him more as a, I don't know, he felt like a character out of Assassin's Creed.
He was like Oberyn in Game of Thrones, and everybody in the cast suggested him. The actor who played him in Game of Thrones to be Amar in the book.
And I don't know why that's bad. Is that bad?
Hell yes. That is. I'm shaking vigorously. Yes.
Yes. That is. Yes. Please. And also, I used to picture Rodrigo as Antonio Banderas because it was at the time that's who I pictured him as.
Oh but yeah.
Now I picture him as the new
Antonio Banderas'
boyfriend. The new Daenerys' boyfriend. The new one? The new one is awesome.
He's good looking. He's just not
really. What about the one they cast before? They recast him, the blonde version. I liked him better.
Really? No, I'd gotten used to him.
Really?
Literally every single thing we say, one of us goes, really?
I did not need to get used to him. I had an immediate affinity for him. So that's how I feel.
Okay, no, it's good. I mean, legitimate. He is one of the lesser of the Game of Thrones man to rule over for me.
Yeah. I like Oberyn.
He's better than Theon.
Everyone's better than Reek. Poor guy.
Did you know he's Lily Allen's brother?
Yeah.
What?
Alfie Allen. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
None of you knew that.
No, you just blew my mind.
That's Alfie Allen. That's Lily Allen's brother. Lily Allen's now more famous than Lily Allen brother.
I don't live here. This is now. There's brains all over this room, and I had to clean it up. Thank you so much.
Sorry.
Bitch. No, I just
wow.
No, I didn't. I don't. I've been drinking. I love it.
Could you just call me a bitch?
Not really. Not really. I was just like in character.
How did this turn into Real Housewives?
I just caught a fly in my hand.
I have been watching Real Housewives.
I have too. This is like Real Housewives of Atlanta pretty quickly.
I could what if I just like splashed wine into the lens of my webcam?
Oh my god, I'd be like, what? I'm a model. It's my model face. I can't believe it just got me in the
lens. I'm casting myself as Nene Leakes in this version of Housewives Vaginal.
We're doing New York. That's what we're doing right now.
Guys, please on Twitter send in hashtag questions because this is derailing so fast.
I have a question. Yeah. So how did you guys think how bigotry and race issues were brought up in the book?
That's a very good question.
See, I can stay on point.
Yeah, you can. What about the, well, the Jewish question, I think, mm-hmm. was one of the main question for me was really.
Well, I thought the Jewish, the Kindeth race had the fewest nuances in their portrayal in this book, because mm-hmm. the Christians, there were good ones and bad ones. You could see both sides, mm-hmm. and that's what it was. Mm-hmm. There were a lot of shades of gray. With the Muslims as well, there were shades of gray. But with the
but Kindeth, not 50 shades of gray.
No, they were not. Did you see that did you see that picture? Did you? Okay, look at my Instagram. They're yeah. insane.
I've seen the picture.
There's
a display of license.
Not only your picture, but then Anne Wheaton, I tweeted on our Vaginal Fantasy Twitter, I retweeted her, there's actually 50 Shades of Grey wine.
Wow.
No, there's 50 Shades of Grey licensed merchandise.
Yeah, I knew there was licensed sex toys.
Oh my God.
I've seen the sex toys, and they look, to be honest, they look a little boring to me for sex toys.
I don't know a lot about it. It was in the women's drugstore next to some chocolates.
It's not on my Wikipedia page, but I do know a lot about sex toys. And these 50 Shades of Grey sex toys are like Target sex toys. They're sad. Sad.
Mm-hmm. Target has sex toys?
Well, not really. They have.
Oh, okay. I was just wondering.
Well, if they did, this is what they sell. This would be what they sell. But then Anne Wheaton tweeted at us all that there's 50 Shades of Grey wine. So I feel like I need to buy it for next time just to see how bad it it feels like it would taste like sweaty rubber and
like rubber and sadness.
Yeah. A lot of depressed, lots of
lots of sad wives.
Like shame.
Maybe it tastes like soccer mom sweat. I don't know.
Yeah, yeah, like soccer mom sweat and shame.
Yeah.
Thanks, Bob, for
inside of a minivan. I don't know.
Anyway. But yeah, I loved your tweet, Felicia, because when I retweeted that, everyone was both shocked and sad that that was in Europe.
Well, it was not in a store that you'd think, oh, handcuffs and whips should be in the back. I mean, it was in the window display next to some really artisanal chocolate.
Wow. Were they fancy chocolate or were they naughty shaped chocolate?
No, they were fancy. I only listen. I'm looking at food 24/7. Okay, I ate my way across the continent, and I lost weight because I walked so much. Isn't that weird?
See, that's how they do it.
Europeans can drink whatever they want because they're walking everywhere. That's why they do it.
It's true, and they have trains. Okay, let's talk about Alvar because we had an interesting point. Olivia says, anyone else feel like Alvar was used and abused the whole story?
Yes.
He's such a nice guy.
I felt so bad for him because, first of all, didn't he have to fight in the nude?
Yes, he fought
in
the nude.
That's dangerous. That is so dangerous. I don't even know how they originally did the Olympics in the nude with all those spears and jousting. That's just a bad idea.
Somebody had to get their pee-pee cut off at some point. I mean,
yeah, maybe that's what would make World Cup more exciting for me is if they were all naked. I don't know.
Why is that exciting?
They should
have the World Cup.
I mean, the cleats would be painful if they, like, got kicked in certain areas, but... Yeah, I feel that he was definitely used and abused. He felt like, and I felt bad for him when all the bad things kept happening to him. He was just like, he's kind of like the Milhouse of this book.
Yeah, but he got out okay.
And he was a noob, you know? Like, he had to go through all that in order to become...
He had to prove himself.
Rodrigo, you know?
I mean, like, imagine what would have happened if he had never heard them talking, if he'd never, like, been, like, taking a piss behind that wagon. Like, yeah, a lot of, he would have not gone through a lot of hell, but at the same time, he became the person he was. He like, found his own destiny. He, like, followed this incredible path with these historical figures in his world that, like, kind of blew his mind. Like, he was always like, oh my God, I can't believe I'm hanging out with Rodrigo Belmonte. This is awesome.
Right.
He got to be that. He got to have
like
that.
A warrior fanboy.
Yeah, he was like, oh my God.
And then at the end,
he has a happy ending, you know?
Do you think his story was sort of like a hero's journey, or do you think it was less than that?
No, I think it was less than that. I don't think it was like chosen one. I think it was like, dude gets swept up in this and makes the best of it that he possibly can.
Yeah. Right. Okay.
Somebody on the forums.
Like Rory.
Oh, Rory from where?
Doctor Who.
Oh yeah, he's kind of like Rory. Yeah,
yeah,
a little bit.
I was like, that's not what happened in Gilmore Girls.
I was literally like, Rory from Gilmore Girls, what?
Yeah, no, she went to Yale. It was different.
Yeah, right. Different. I know, sorry. I should have thought Doctor Who immediately. I'm sorry. Yeah, I was kind of like that, because he... I always felt like Rory was the most romantic of the whole Doctor Who series, because he waited by her side for, like, was it hundreds of years or something? I mean,
She waited thousands of years, too, though.
Yeah, that's true. They both... There's a lot of waiting.
A lot of waiting when time travel's involved.
Yeah.
Question for the forum. It forums. Carvassia asks, do you ever do Kill F. Mary? It's between the three characters, Amar, Rodrigo, and Alvar.
Sure.
Amar, Rodrigo, Alvar, Kill F. Mary. Which?
Well, then that means we're going to have... Oh, that's not fair.
Lots of things.
What's not fair?
I'm going to have to kill Jahane now. Oh, with Alvar. Oh.
No, it's the three dudes.
You can add Jahane in there. Yeah, add Jahane. It doesn't just have to be the dudes.
That's true.
But don't you have to pick one of each? So you can only have three because you have to do one to the other. Doesn't someone have to be killed?
Yeah, if you don't want to, you just want to get rid of one of them.
We can make up our own rules. You know what? This is our show. We do what we
want. Yeah, you can do whatever you want.
Okay, I would marry Rodrigo. Because we're already married. We have the same last name. Yeah, I would F Amar because he's like really poetic and seems like he'd be pretty good in bed, and he's like in good shape, and he could read me poetry after, and that'd be pretty awesome. Sing me a song, but I don't want to have to kill Alvar. Like, he was awesome.
I don't know.
I would also marry him.
You can have two.
Okay.
I don't think anybody. In our world we can marry more than one person. Is that?
Why not?
I got it. Okay, I would marry Amar because then I could. Then you can have him every night. So then I don't know why you just is really.
Oh, huh.
Right, well, think about.
Wait, you didn't say there was a night limit. I could marry Rodrigo and then just have sex with Amar.
What if we did marry F lover?
What?
So what if we did marry?
Stay on point, Kyla. Stay on point.
Oh, wait, F is the same as lover.
Yeah, well...
Marry F, make Mary me a sandwich.
Marry F, best friend.
I would have Alvar make
you one of them. You can murder one of them with your bare hands.
Marry F, oral sex. Am I allowed to say that?
I'm sorry. Murder and oral sex. I'm afraid for you.
What is going on?
I don't know. Kyla's changing up the rules all of a sudden because she doesn't want to kill anyone.
I don't.
I'm not going to actually kill
And she doesn't
anyone.
Want to go all the way.
Oh, they're not real people.
How about instead of kill, publicly shun?
Oh,
that's mean. I'd rather kill someone than publicly shun them.
I'd rather just shit. I just shiv someone. That almost came
shiv?
Out
Shiv? You said shiv, right? I'm just making sure.
I know. I thought
they were
going to
poop on someone.
Okay.
Okay. That could, yeah.
I did say shiv. I said shiv. I would rather just shank someone.
Everybody's saying to kill Alvar, okay? Everybody meaning.
Oh. Like, don't kill Milhouse.
You guys are so mean about Alvar. Alvar and the chipmunks.
Well, how did you feel about the epilogue when the first
half of the
epilogue?
I don't get to kill and have sex with people. What the hell?
No, but the first half of the epilogue, the author fakes us out and implies that Alvar marries Jahane.
Right.
Did anybody else get that?
Yes.
I was so angry at that point, I wanted to kill Alvar myself. I wanted to reach in the book and be like, no, sir. You are not meant for her.
I don't think he did marry, wasn't
it? No, he did. He didn't. He was married, but he wasn't married to her. He was married to the daughter of his teacher.
Yeah. But the author faked it out, so you kind of thought that they got together.
He faked out a lot of things. There was fake out deaths all the way throughout this book. It was a little irritating.
Well, that's just kind of his thing, though.
That's his thing. Well, bad poetry.
Okay, so Kyle, who are you picking? Come on, chop chop.
Oh, I'm sorry. Mary Rodrigo, obviously. F. Alvar, because he's young man. And then I guess I'd have to kill
Amar?
Amar.
You're going to kill Amar?
I don't want to kill him. I would like to just keep him around as
I would kill
him. I'd like to keep him around as an option for a second husband.
Mike already did. You can maybe share him. He could just be shares.
Oh, let's share him.
Listen, I would kill Rodrigo. I'm just going to say it. I would kill Rodrigo because I feel like killing him would be a really satisfying warrior situation. Like, it could be epic. And when I saw them, so Amar and Rodrigo at the end have to fight to the death. And that's the cliffhanger. You don't know who dies in the end of the book. But this fight scene is probably the best fight scene I've ever read in a book. Mm. And you're reading it, and you're seeing John Woo doves just like, and like slow motion, and the agony between these two best friends who are now on the opposite sides of a religious war have to duel to the death. It is the most romantic thing I've ever read, and so
it's very epic.
So I would want to be involved in that John Woo fight to kill Rodrigo, and then I'd kiss him on the brow as he died in my arms. Okay.
Oh.
I know that was pretty heartbreaking.
Oh.
Yeah. It was bad.
I kiss him on the sideburns.
Ew.
Why?
Oh. You get hair in your teeth. Anyway.
Okay.
Why would I use my teeth? What kind of kissing are you doing, Bonnie?
You're like... Okay, Gary has a very interesting question for the forums. Because
you guys want to know my picks.
All right, Bonnie, do the thing.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, well, my options are open because, you know. So I'm going to go ahead and say that I'm going to sleep with Zabria.
Okay, she wasn't an novel.
She was the daughter, right?
Okay. No, she was the singer from the court, the most beautiful mistress in the world.
I'll marry Jahan.
Courtesan. Yeah, you're right.
I'll marry Jahan, and then I'll kill Miranda, because...
Why did you kill Miranda?
Why not?
She was amazing.
Because she was awesome and badass and shot dudes with arrows and was like, no, you're not taking my sons. F you.
Yeah.
An epic battle. See, I'm not killing people because I hate them. I would kill them because it would be fun to battle them. Like Felicia did.
But if you killed her, then they take her sons, and then also they were gonna... Weren't they gonna rape her?
I'm not part of the storyline.
No, she's just taking the characters.
You're right. I'm sorry. I had a lot of wine, so...
I would not sleep with Jahan because I think she probably sounds pretty boring in bed.
Yeah, no, Sabrina, I would say yes to that because she was trained in all the worldly arts. There was a very one of the most.
She's like Inara. She's Inara.
Yeah. Well, do you think she's like trained in all the sex stuff?
Yeah.
Like Top Chef. Like is she like what do you mean worldly arts can mean anything? I mean that's
she was like a consort, like a, you know, she's like...
concubine.
Companion.
She knew the moves. Even Amar said that she knew all the moves and he was impressed. Remember when they had the sexy times?
Well, then I guess it's a good thing I'm marrying her because you don't want sex to die when you get married, so there you go.
Yeah, you'll be stuck with her.
What do you mean stuck with her?
wait, who are we talking about? I was looking at something else.
Sabrina.
Why does the married
no, she'd be good.
Group immediately say I'd be stuck with someone?
She'd be too wild. I think you're right. You want to marry Jahan because she's like, you know, she's level.
Yeah.
She'll clean your infected wounds if you, like, I mean, it is 1492.
She's got that urine flask.
You want to marry someone who has the most skill sets because they'll come in handy. You don't want to sleep with someone that's good at everything. You just want to sleep with someone who's good at sex. Like, I don't care if they know how to cook.
Yeah. Should we make you a sandwich after? I mean, you'd like that. The sandwich. Everyone wants a sandwich after sex.
I do.
I don't know.
Always.
I would never want a sandwich.
I know.
After? No, you don't want a sandwich before sex. You want a sandwich after sex.
Yeah, you don't want sex like when there's a roast beef sandwich in your stomach. That's just bad.
Yeah, you don't want it before.
Cold cuts after all that. No.
Well, it's like swimming. You don't swim right after you eat. So if you have a sandwich, you're going to have to wait a half hour before sexy time starts.
But Felicia's saying that she doesn't want a sandwich even after.
That's just so weird to have, like, a savory craving of cold cuts afterwards.
Well, you'd be hungry. Who says it's cold cuts? I just said sandwich. You're saying cold cuts.
Yeah, I mean, it could be a crazy sandwich. You know?
It could be a lobster roll. It could be grilled cheese.
A nice caprese. Yeah.
That's what I just said.
Did you say that? Because I would also like a caprese sandwich.
I did. That's what I know. I'm just thinking about it. I'm just like, I would really
like a sloppy Joe unless you're incorporating it in sex.
Stoppy Joe for sex.
Veronica and I are just like, it's just some tomatoes and some really good mozzarella. And
like, can we just skip the sex and have the sandwich?
I think we just found the title for this episode is sandwich. Let's take it to Twitter. Who likes to have sandwiches after sex? Tell us your favorite sandwich.
Who likes sandwiches instead of sex?
I swear to God, I'm binge watching Top Chef, and now I want this to be an elimination challenge.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe a panini.
A nice panini.
A nice thin panini.
And you don't want anything mozzarella. That, too garlicky, because you might kiss after, so you don't want anything too pungent.
Yeah, if you both smell like garlic, nobody cares.
What about something with, I had something like this in Spain. It had figs and goat cheese and drizzle.
I've had that.
Yeah, I mean, that would be
balsamic.
That would be tasty and sensual if you could get past the part that there's wasp eggs inside of figs, you'll be fine.
What the hell, Bonnie?
Why would you do that?
What are you talking about?
Google it.
No, I'm not Googling it.
Oh, yeah, God, you're an awful human being.
Yeah, so those crunchy bits, that isn't just seeds.
Don't stop.
Get out of here. Stop it. Stop it. You're ruining my life.
I like the worst. I can eat a wasp. I don't care.
I love how I can see her, like, as we're talking about this, she's, like, wiggling and, like, glee to herself that she's, like, ruining figs for us forever. She's like, oh.
It's just protein.
I mean, eat your wasps, ladies.
We can talk about there's bug parts in pretty much everything you eat. Peanut butter, everything.
That's true.
Everyone's
sandwich, Bonnie.
Sorry. I still eat figs. I don't care. I mean, it's just crunchy.
Okay, no. I'm not believing this. I'm not believing it.
Can we take a question from Twitter before I ruin all foods for everybody?
Twitter is just talking about the cold cuts. They have no observations except Adrian Jones, who continues to be the best participant in the Bachelor by actually quoting the book and being intelligent.
Yeah, about the actual book that we read.
Okay, I'll bring up a question. I'll bring up a question because this is something that I did want to know from each of you, because I feel like I'm the horrible person that always looks for sex in a book. Did you guys think there was enough romance in this book, or would you have liked to have seen more?
It didn't matter to me because the book was so good. I honestly didn't miss it.
Okay.
So I think that's for me.
It was more than your average historical fantasy. Mm-hmm. Like, it was more detailed than your average.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I thought I was, you know, more would have been nice, but I think it would have changed the story too much, and I liked the story as it was.
Are there any of the side characters that you wish had more of a stake in the story? Like any of the, because a lot of times when we read these books for Vaginal Fantasy, I know for me, I end up liking some of the side characters more than the main characters, and I was just curious if any of you, since we have a zillion characters to choose from, were there any characters that were kind of mentioned, but you didn't really get backstory on them that you wished there was, like, more about them?
Sabrina.
Yes.
I'm a sucker for a concubine story. I don't know why.
Me too.
Me too.
She was in my top three to have sex with.
Yeah. I think that's why we love Tagana, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Such a good book.
I'm trying to keep it on point. You guys sound bored already.
I think we're all just like Tagana.
They want us to talk about casting now.
Okay. All right. Why don't we wrap it up and get to this?
But just for the record, this guy Sean says meatball sub. Disgusting, dude. That is too much garlic in it.
But no. I don't want to eat that after sex. Come on.
No.
Maybe a pizza with champagne, like an hour later after you.
A couple people are saying pizza, but I don't know. It's so greasy.
Yeah, because you might like make out after, or if the food falls on them, you might lick it off. And I don't want to lick off marinara off anyone.
Oh, gross! That's the worst. Hey, by the way, I was in Paris and I had a French pizza.
What was that?
It's really good. It's like here, I'll tweet a picture of it.
Is it like a crepe?
Yeah, no, it's on a thin crust. It's kind of like a lavash, bread. And then it's long and thin, and they bake it so it's crispy, and they put a cream sauce on it, like a creamy garlic sauce. And the one that I had prosciutto and honey and figs on it, but it was so good. I'm going to tweet a picture.
Just you shut up. You shut up right now, buddy. Don't say it about the figs.
Anyway, don't talk about the figs. Okay. Gary, by the way, Gary from the forum had a very good question before we do casting. What would be, if you had to follow one religion from a fictional universe, what would it be?
Oh.
That was a really good question.
If we did what? Fictional character?
What any religion, if you had to be an inherent to any religion in any fantasy or history, you know, any fictional universe.
Oh, well, I do enjoy the Kushal Start, the hers.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
Wilt.
Yeah, Love as Thou Wilt, and then also, you know, I'm obviously just like, I'm like, you know, I yield.
Yeah. Okay, so that's a good one. What about the people from Dune? Wasn't there?
Oh yes, Fremen. I like the Fremen.
That's what I want to be.
Well, yeah.
Benny Gesserit.
Yes, yeah. I would not want to be a Benny Gesserit, but I would want to be a Fremen.
Okay.
That's a tough question though, because like, I don't know. Like most religions are pretty judgmental, and fictional or non-fictional. So it's like. I guess Kushal's Dart for me, too. Well, Dune's a good choice, too. I'm trying to think of how many books we've read that have religion as part of the book.
Well, like, would you want to be a Jedi?
Like a Jedi Knight?
Yeah, that's part of a religion.
Jedi, I mean, this is something that I firmly believe, and I've always thought that Jedi were, like, the pompous straight-A kids in school that were kind of jerks and condescending. To me, if we're going to go Star Wars and we're going to do religion, I would be one of the Knight Sisters. Because that was a witchcrafty type thing that's in Expanded Universe and Clone Wars, and I think they're bringing it into the new Star Wars stuff. So I liked that because it used spirituality and witchcraft, and it's very witchy, but it's not like bad. It's like White Witch, but they know dark arts as well. So if we're going to do Star Wars, then I wonder, what religion are Wookiees? And I think more like the Native Americans of Star Wars because they're really into like clans and they're into like tribes and I don't know.
I really like the you know in the White Queen just that they just use some like you know old family.
Oh yeah, that was good.
I like that. I like that it was you know it's just sort of based on woodcraft.
Any kind of naturistic type religion. Yeah. I like religion when it's based on elements and not based on a guy that looks like a doobie brother.
Right, yeah, exactly. Yeah, you don't have a doobie. Ooh. You have Michael McDonald in the sky going.
Well, I would want to be... I liked that... What was that book we read with the swans?
Mm. Oh, yeah. Oh, the swans.
They were actually kind of bad. Swans. Like, having, like...
That was Philippa Gregory, wasn't it? No, it was the other one. It was a forest daughter.
The daughter of the forest. No, like but that sounds kind of sucky, actually. I don't think I'd want to be in part of that mythology.
I thought you were anti-swan. I didn't think you were pro-swan.
What?
I thought you were anti-swan and not pro-swan.
I'm not. You know, it's funny. I said what, and I put my ear to the microphone. Like, putting the ear towards the microphone would help me hear you better.
What? I'm sorry.
I would like to be a druid, like in the Iron Druid Chronicles.
You know,
be able to have tattoos all over my body and be able to, like, you know, talk to the earth elementals and be able to, like, do bindings and stuff like that.
That'd be a really good series.
You still can be a druid. That's actually a religion that's still going.
But I wish the magic really worked.
You don't know, does it?
I don't know
that it doesn't.
No,
but
you don't.
I'm pretty sure I can't cast camouflage on myself. But that would be awesome.
You don't know. PETA did. And I, you know. He couldn't do anything. So
he can't do anything. I'm completely codependent.
It was the mother bread.
Oh, boy. Okay.
We gotta do
casting.
Guys, I have casting.
I do, okay. Too. You go first, Veronica, because you never do casting, so this will be good.
Okay, so obviously, I think we can all agree that Pedro Pascal, who played Oberyn Martell, has to be Amar. Yeah.
That was one of the number one suggestions on the forum, including also Alistair from Dragon Age, which I thought was interesting.
Oh, that is,
because
that's
it's
not
a
real guy.
Alistair is a little too, isn't Alistair blonde?
Yeah, he's blonde, but I don't know. That's
yeah, I don't buy it.
As I still, you're a lady elf.
And bear with me on this one, a slightly younger than right now Jeremy Irons for Rodrigo.
Oh, a young Jeremy Irons.
Like, yeah. He's like 65-ish now, so maybe like a age 55 Jeremy Irons.
That's pretty hot, yeah.
And then for Jahane, I don't know where I came up with this, but Emily Blunt.
Yes!
I can really see her.
She's supposed to be...
I would love that.
Okay.
Wait. How old is Jahane supposed to be in the book? I forget.
Late 20s.
Okay. Go ahead.
I thought, I'm in love with Eva Green right now because of Penny Dreadful, which is so good.
Oh, yeah, you were talking about that with someone today. Who were you talking with that on the internet?
I don't know, but it was Paul F. Tompkins.
Oh, yes, that's what
it was. Yeah, no big deal. You're just talking to Paul F. Tompkins about being dreadful. No, NBD.
No, I've never met him. I just follow him on Twitter. He wasn't even following me, and I was like, I'm going to enter this conversation because I was stuck at an airport. But
I do that, too.
She's so good. I would want her to be Jahane, and then Pedro Pascal, of course, and then Rodrigo. I was having a hard time with Rodrigo, but I like this Jeremy Irons a lot. I mean, that might be the best one of anything I could think of, Veronica. You did really good.
Yes, casting!
I forget how some of these characters are described, so I just, in my mind's eye, just kept, like, putting Mexican and Spanish actors in, or people that I think could be in there. That's fair. And I know Spain and Mexico are totally two different nationalities.
So don't yell at her, internet.
But I'm going to say, Amar, I didn't have anybody because I couldn't really, I don't know. That's a hard one. For Jahane, I was thinking between Eva Green and Rachel Weisz.
Oh, that was a common one online, and that's a good one.
Rachel Weisz was my choice.
They might be a little bit too old, so then maybe Natalie Portman, but then I noticed on our forum, someone said Veronica.
Really?
Veronica.
Oh, interesting. And no one said Kyla. Okay,
Sorry. Maybe, I don't know.
So I can show you. Would you like to see my pee flask?
Yeah, I would. I would very much like to see your pee flask. Are you going to show me your go girl thing?
Oh, that's an even better idea.
I was going to show you. Hold on, wait for it. Oh, Kyla, that was such a better idea. You were so much funnier than I am.
Thank you.
There you go. There's my pee flask.
Nice.
Did you see it while I was talking? I couldn't tell from your facial expression.
Boop.
Are you using it?
Yeah, I should
pee
flask. Hold on.
Are you using it?
No, that was an unopened one.
Okay. I don't know. Like, everyone has a certain expression when they pee, so I couldn't tell if you were peeing or not.
Here's my pee flask.
How do you pee?
Oh, my God. That is a short laser one.
Yeah, they made it for me at Nerdtacular, but just pee in
there. Why are you calling it a pee flask? Am I wrong?
Because that's what was in the book.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Urine flask is a key prop in the first part of the book.
Yeah, okay. So then you can analyze your pee and see what's going on with your humors.
I don't know how to get this back in this thing.
Is that weird? I would like to be able to analyze my own pee and see what's wrong.
Me too. I would absolutely love to do that.
In real life, we have to give a stool pee sample, so that's just, normal.
Well, yeah, if I remember correctly, I'm not sure if it's Japan or in a different country in Asia, but they do examine in the squat toilets. They take a moment to look at their poo and make sure that everything's cool. And I think we should be able to do that too. I think it makes sense.
There's a lot more parasites there because of sushi eating.
I don't think so.
I do look at my poo.
That's something that when you're eating raw meat as a primary thing as a nationality, you're going to have more parasite probability than most of us who don't eat sushi every day. That is an issue.
It's true.
Because I had a sushi problem, and my doctor told me, first of all, you're going to die of mercury poisoning if you keep doing this, and also there's the chance that you will get more parasites. So I had to stop eating sushi every day.
Guys, I can't get the pee funnel back in its little tunnel.
Okay, Kyla, we want to wrap it up.
I didn't finish my casting because you guys are talking about urine all of a sudden.
What is your casting?
Okay, so Jahane or whatever, I was thinking either Eva Green or Veronica, and then all of a sudden we're talking about urine. And then Rodrigo, I would say Javier Bardem.
That's a nice choice.
But then I was thinking maybe the lead guy from The Bridge.
Oh.
The American version.
Just thought of Gerard Butler, so I thought of that too.
Oh, yeah, that could work too. Okay, and then for Zabria Paz Vega or Penelope Cruz. And then Miranda was Catherine Zeta-Jones for me. I don't know why.
Oh, that's good.
I liked her, yes.
That's a good idea.
Okay, that's my casting.
Right. Kyla, what's your casting? Wrap it up for us.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I did it. Rodrigo, you know what? I am going to go with Gerard Butler. And then I'm going to go with Alvar is James McAvoy. Shut up. It could be. You don't know. and then Amar. Did I do it right this time, finally? I can't. Well, we said Oberyn, but I also think that the Daenerys' boyfriend or new boyfriend is pretty good,
okay.
too. So either one. But then for Jahan, definitely Eva Greener, but I definitely for me, Rachel Weisz.
Who?
Rachel Weisz.
Yeah.
Weisz. Whatever.
I've never heard her name. Okay. Well, that's good. Okay, well, this was a great pick. Thank you, Kyla, for your monthly pick.
Yeah, awesome. By the way, Kyla, since you picked the alt book too, right?
I picked the alt book.
No. Mistress of the Art. Okay. I just want to say, even though we don't talk about, I guess we're not talking about the alt book anymore on the shows, right?
We're in a test phase of doing that, but a lot of people talked about the book everybody talks about the book on the forums, and ideally we talk about the book.
I know that you want to do author Q&A on the forums, but the author of that book's dead, so you can't really. I mean,
yeah.
We could do like a Ouija board Q&A, but.
No.
I just wanted to say, for Mistress of the Art of Death, I really, really, really liked that book.
Yeah. Well,
I will go on the forums and talk about it, but I just want to say for our viewers that read the alt book this month, I really liked it. So if you want to talk about it on forums or tweet me your thoughts, I have to say and it's weird because the author's dead, so I don't know how far the series goes.
There's about 6 books, and it's fine. The alt book is supposed to be for discussing on the forums, so okay. I haven't gotten there yet to discuss it, but I definitely want to because I read all of them, and I love that series so much. So
I have a question for you, and maybe some of our viewers might have the same question. Does the book series end satisfyingly, even though the author died and maybe had a couple more books in them?
I think that the last book I didn't really love as much. So it kind of ended for me after like 4 or 5.
Okay. So, the thing, my pet peeve is I hate starting book series and then this sounds really horrible and selfish, but then the author dies and then I don't get like the ending and closure I need for a series.
There's enough closure in the first 3 or 4 books that I think. And stop, and then if you want to keep going, it's just kind of extra. Okay,
highly recommend the alt book. If any of you guys have read it, please, or haven't read it, go for it because it was really good.
I like it.
It's Bonnie. It's your choice.
Okay.
What is your choice?
So I'm picking for the main book, Greywalker by Kat Richardson.
You even have the covers.
Yeah, the cover actually is very reminiscent of the cover of the first book we read for the very first Vaginal Fantasy. Was it like a ghost?
It was Grave Witch, and guess what? The next one in that series comes out, I think, at Comic-Con, and I'm going to talk to the author because I love that series so much.
So anyway, when we first started Vaginal Fantasy, I thought our first book might have been Greywalker, but Greywalker is by Kat Richardson. It's the first in a series of books. Kat is one of my favorite authors, and I really, really love this book. So, I actually talked with all of you guys earlier today because I was either going to pick this book or a book I had never read before that might have had more sex in it. So I'm glad that we all decided that it was cool if I picked
the book you want. If it's our month, pick the book you want, and then
So that's the main book, and then Felicia and I thought it would be cool if the alt book could be Death's Daughter by Amber Benson.
Yes.
I think we all know Amber, and I'm friends with her, and I think you guys are friends with her too. And her book series is really fun. It's a young adult book series, but there's romance in it. It's got a great sense of humor, and it's called Death's Daughter, and it's a whole series, so I highly recommend it. So that'll be the alt book.
Yeah, and I'm gonna I'll send her an email because not this month, but last month the author came and did a Q&A on the forum toward the end of the month to coincide with our hangout. So I'll try to get her to do that if she can.
I think Amber would
be amazing.
I think she would be game for that because she. Yeah. And for those of you who don't know, Amber Benson is, if you're a fan of Buffy, she played Willow's girlfriend on Buffy.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
She's a really well-known actress as well, but she's an amazing. Amazing writer, which I was kind of shocked by because I always known her as an actress, not necessarily an author. So I'm glad that she decided to cultivate that other creative side of her as well. And it's a great book series.
Yeah. And she's from here, Portland, Oregon, where I won't be living for very much longer.
So. That's right. Kyla's moving to LA. So all of your viewers from LA, make her feel at home when she gets there.
Please do.
Oh, we'll have to go to the NoHo cream pies.
That's what I'm thinking.
Guys, we will see you on the next Vaginal Fantasy. It will be the 29th of July, and I will see you guys then.
I'm gonna be on a panel on Comic Con.
Oh yeah, I forgot to talk about Comic Con.
Is that all right?
Let's talk about Comic Con.
Okay.
Yeah. Go for it.
Okay, so I'm gonna be on a panel with Anana and Paul Guinan, and they wrote Boilerplate, this one. I don't know, it's super awesome, and I don't know if I'm allowed to talk about J.J. Abrams, so I'm just going to throw that name out there and not talk about what the deal is. But anyways, so but it's really cool. He's a robot, and it's awesome. So anyways, but the panel is actually about women in the comic industry, and we've got men on the panel who have been doing comics. And so, you know, I mean, obviously this issue is blowing up. So that's what we're going to be talking about. And we've got some really cool panelists.
You're going to be talking about your comic, right? Because you did a Womanthology comic like I did.
I will talk about my comic, but there's also going to be, I got it right here, Jimmy Palmiotti, who did Painkiller Jane. There's me. There's Allison Baker, Monkey Brain Comics, and Claire Hummel, who did Bioshock Infinite. I think she did all the graphic art and stuff or something. Mm-hmm. I could be wrong. And we're just going to talk about sexism, science fiction, comic books, and geek culture, and it's going to be pretty great. And it's on Thursday, so. Thursday.
Okay, great. Yeah. And then, Bonnie, are you doing any panels?
I am, but I forgot what they
were. Okay, we'll just follow our Twitter. We have a Geek Center offsite.
Okay, I forget my panels, but I usually tweet them. So yeah. when I get to Comic-Con or closer to Comic-Con, I'll tweet out what they are. But I am going to be doing some book signings and some espionage cosmetic nail wrap stuff with Anne Wheaton. So I will be there, but also, and I feel horrible that Veronica's not going to be at Comic-Con this year because you usually do cool zombie stuff, right?
I'm really, yeah. I just refuse to believe it. I just can't, I can't deal with it.
It's okay. I've been traveling too much anyway, so it'll be nice to have a little time off.
Well, nice for you.
I'm going to make a little, Veronica puppet that I can bring with us, so you'll be there in spirit.
Okay.
But I know that, Felicia, you probably have a good Geek and Sundry announcement because they're going to be there, right?
Yeah, we're going to have a panel Saturday at 6 p.m., and then also we are going to have an offsite event that's open to anybody. It's free of charge, and you don't have to have a badge to go. We'll have video games set up and tabletop games and parties at night that are open to the public. So come by on Thursday or Friday, follow the Geek & Sundry Twitter to see when. And we're going to try to arrange an hour Vaginal Fantasy hangout, meet up for drinks or something. Stay tuned.
I'll bring this, which is called Slash, and it's a romance fan fiction board game, like a card game, and it's like a romance. It's like if Vaginal Fantasy had a card game, this might be it. So I'll bring this to Geek & Sundry, because I feel like I might be hiding out at the Geek & Sundry Joel and Joe thing.
I'll be there too with you.
Yeah, because Comic-Con can be really overwhelming with so many people and smells and sights and sounds that I need to decompress. So I figure I will be at the Geek & Sundry probably more than I'll be at Comic-Con. So just come find me and I'll bring this on the play games.
Yeah.
Me too.
All right. Well, we'll see you guys down in San Diego, and if not, we will see you somewhere else or here next month. Yes. Thanks for watching. Bye.
Bye. Bye.